Who? Okay, we will start. All a very warm welcome to our webinar, Quality You Cannot Beat, Red Beat Discussed. I'm very happy with this amount of visitors I see. Growers, dealers, traders, all a very warm welcome. I see different countries. I'm Ronald Hand from Bejo Benelux. I'm a red beet specialist in this area and also a red beet also a sales representative. In my area, red beet is a trendy crop with a lot of healthy purposes. And this day, Bejo wants to share his knowledge about red beet with you. We want to discuss trends, developments, and other important cases in the red beet market in Europe. Because we see a lot of positive movements, but also challenges. So you have different speakers. I will show you. Robert Schilder, crop manager for the red beet, will tell you about the acreages and trends in Western Europe. And Lisbeth van der Heijden, senior researcher, seed pathology, will give a presentation about the developments in seed coatings. Marcel Krimp, international sales representative, will tell you about the purposes of red beet in his area, Eastern Europe. And after that, we show you a film about the new generation varieties. And Jack van Dorp, our breeding manager, red beet, will do that. And when you have questions, please use the chat function on the right. And after each presentation, we will answer some questions. So let's start with Robert. Welcome, Robert.
Good morning, everybody. As Ronald mentioned, my name is Robert Schilder. I'm one of the crop managers of the area Western Europe, and I'm involved with the red beets. And I'm going to show you what's happening with red beets in Europe. First of all, I'm going to tell something about the countries, which acreages they have, which varieties they are using, something about the market developments, and something about the market demands. I will close my session with some slides about taste. And from that moment, our breeder, Jacques van Dorp, will take it over, and he will say something more about what they are doing in breeding. The first country is the biggest in Western Europe, it's Poland. They are having more than 16,500 hectares. The main variety for early is the Wodan and the Boro, Subeto, Action, Pablo, Bicoris, Betolo and Bresco are the biggest varieties for the round ones. For the long ones, they are using Alto and Taunus, and for the yellow and the white one, the Boulder and the Avalanche. It's a stable market for industry and a fresh market, and the market for the long types is increasing. And of the long types, the Alto is the number one. Alto is a very smooth, cylindrical, uniform long type. And there is a growing interest for the yellow and the white ones. And the market demand is they are looking for varieties with a high betanin and a high Brex level up to 10. The next one is France, the second biggest in Europe, up to almost 3,000 hectares. It's a stable market since 5 years. And there is some more interest for growing red beets over there. The biggest area is the center of France. It's responsible for 50% of the total acreage, but it will decrease because of some issues with Rhizomania. The biggest varieties are Action, Manzou, Red Ace, Ronda, Bertollo, Pablo, Bohan, Palau, Bresco, Manolo, and for organic, Ronda and Boro. And for the monogerm varieties, the Moneta, for the long types, the Alto, and for the yellow, the Boldor, and the white, the Avalanche. That's what I said, the center of France, they are expecting that the acreage is going down in that area and that it's going to move to other areas without the problems of Rhizomania. And there is an interest in the diversity of other colors. Also, they are looking for a high Brix, up to 10%. And they are looking for strong varieties against the Rhizoctonia and the Rhizomania and a good storage ability. And it's what I said, around and more interest in monogerm. The next country, that are a couple, that's Germany, Austria, and Switzerland. Altogether, more than 2,500 hectares. Germany is the biggest. The round types are the biggest market for fresh and industry. The long types, Alto and Taunus, are popular by the industry. And we are having a very strong market share over there. Palau, Boro, Red Ace and Pablo are the biggest. Bazou and Bresco are new. And Moneta is the variety for the monogerm. And for the long types, they are also using Taunus and Alto for the yellow, the Boldor, white, the Avalanche. In Austria, good market share with Taunus for the industry, for conventional and organic. And Rhizomania is an upcoming problem in Austria. But we are lucky we have three varieties who are resistant against Rhizomania. The fresh market is going more into organic. If you count it out, it's within those three countries, it's 1/3 of the total acreage of red beets is already organic. That's quite much. Discounter supermarkets are only offering 500 gram bags. It's a little bit old fashioned, and the Boro and the Bresco are performing very well. The market demands is healthy leaves and Rhizomania resistant. For Switzerland, a very good market share over there too. Rhizomania resistant is a must, because they are facing a lot of problems with this disease. It's a soil-borne disease. And Rhizomania resistance varieties Manzou, Palau, and Bazou are performing very well. Harvesting will be with machine. It's getting more and more popular because of a lack of labor. And this is what we are facing all over Europe. Organic is becoming more and more important, and most of the organic is meant for the fresh market. The market demands are varieties who are strong against Septoria. That's a leaf disease. If you talk about the UK, the biggest varieties over there are the Pablo, Action, Bertollo, Manolo, and Palau. For the long types, it's the Alto. For the yellow, again, the Boldor. For white, the Avalanche. And they are also using Chocchia types. In total, they have up to 2,000 hectares, and a small part of it, around 100 hectares, is organic. New product developments in fresh prepared from continues to grow at the expense of the traditional void of and or vacuum packed products. Bunched beetroots are several years of steady growth, but it's now stable. And there has been a strong demand of consumers during COVID as home eating increased. However, the demand is going back to normal levels. And the colors are a niche market, and they are declining a little bit this year. The main market in the UK are beets for the smaller beets. They are drilling up to 1.5 million seeds the hectare. That's quite a lot. And that's why they are using Pablo Action and Subeta for this purpose. And another market demand is seed hygiene will become increasingly important as chemical seed treatments become less available in the future. At this moment in Europe, we do have nothing. There are no chemicals available for doing seed treatment. The next one is Spain. Spain is also an important country, up to 1,583 hectares. The center of Spain is 10% for bunching and 90% for industry. And in Andalusia, everything for the fresh market during the last 30 years. And they are exporting a lot to the UK. The main varieties over there are Pablo, Boro, Manzoo, Red Ace, Action, Palau, Bohan, Ronda, Manolo, and Palau. And the Alt Avalon, Yellow, the Boldor, and White, the Avalanche. Market demands are for the center of Spain, special emphasis of diseases like Rhizomania, and they are looking for types which are good for storage. And in the Andalusia area, that's the south part of Spain, consumers are happy with the quality of Pablo. It's the biggest variety over there. And for the south, the market is looking for smooth and attractive varieties. Organic is quite important, and the high density must be adapted. So again, Pablo is very suitable for that purpose. For Holland and Belgium, most important are the round red beets, fresh and industry. Pablo is a very common variety, but next to that, Boro, Subeto, Bresco, Manzoo and Bazoo are very popular for the round ones, and for the industry, the Alto and the Taunus, for yellow, the Boldor, for the white one, the Avalanche, and for the Chioccia types, it's the Anello. Altogether, it's up to 1,000 hectares. And again, 1/3 of the total acreage is meant for organic. That's also quite a lot. The market demands are healthy leaves and Rhizoctonia-resistant varieties for type A and also type B. And type B is not available at the moment. And they are also looking for high levels of bricks up to 10. And the last one in this range, that's Denmark, Italy, and Czech altogether. Denmark is growing up to 300 hectares. And also in Denmark, 1/3 of the total acreage is meant for organic. In Italy, it's mainly conventional. It's 230 hectares. And in Czech, it's also mainly conventional, up to 230 hectares. And just a small part is organic. The most popular varieties are Boro, Pablo, Bresco, Wodan, Ronda, Manolo, and Moneta. And for the long types, it's the Taunus and the Alto, and the yellow, the Boldor, and the white, the Avalanche. In Denmark, the long types are dominant in the market. For organic production, the round types are more popular. It's a ratio of 40% for the long types and 60% for the round ones. Rhizomania is not a big problem yet. We see it here and there coming up. In Italy, it's a stable but small market. And what I said, only the round ones are popular. And in Czech, it's also a very small market, but we see a steady growth. Market demands are smooth skin, good internal color, high yield, healthy and strong leaves, nice uniformity, and a lot of disease resistances like Rhizomania, Rhizoctonia, Septoria, and so on and so on. And the monoderm varieties are getting more and more popular. That's what was it about the countries. Now something about what's Bayo doing on taste. It's all about taste, because if the varieties are not having a good taste, they are less popular by the consumer. We are doing for the last 3 years a lot of investments in investigations after taste. We are doing it together with the University of Wageningen. And our motivation is, because we are a market leader, it's for us our third crop. We need to have a better information to discuss it with our customers. Next to that, chain innovations, additional information for our indirect customers, like processors and retail. Also, they want to know more about taste. And we want to compare our varieties and competitive varieties. So in the taste trials, there are not only ours, but also some of our competitors. And we need to have a better understanding what's happening during storage. And next to that, we want to get more information in breeding to improve our varieties on taste. That's what I said, we are doing together with the Wageningen University and research. Next to that, our partners are the Julius Kühn Institute in Germany and our partner in the UK, Elsums. Wageningen University has a research panel of 20 to 25 tasting experts. They know exactly how to taste, what to taste, and they can give it a very good description. They will have randomized order of varieties under code, so they don't know what they are tasting and which varieties and so on and so on. They taste the presence of bite, aromas and taste, and they are analyzing the data on a statistical way, and they are presenting it in facts. The research design is beet taste trials with 12 commercial varieties, 6 each time, so they can't taste more than 6 varieties in just one time. It's in cooperation with sales, breeding and phytopathology, and next to that, extended content matter analysis like bricks, dry matter, betanine and geosmin. Taste trials with an expert panel, and we are looking after it before and after storage, because we want to know what's going on during that process. And it's we are looking for a relation between taste and content matters. Now, till now, we have some conclusions. There is a correlation between dry matter and bricks, high correlation with each other. And we also see positive trends with aroma presence, beetroot aroma, and sweetness. During storage, taste is changing during storage, influenced by content matter. And if you talk about varieties, there are no big differences between varieties. Taste is influenced by soil type, growing conditions, stress, and climate. But still, the best tasting varieties are also the best tasting varieties on soil types which are not the best for growing beets on. So that's why we want to know more about taste. From now, Jack van Dorp is going to take it over, and he will tell a lot about what Bayo is doing in breeding red beets.
Okay, it should work better. Thank you, Robert. So my name is Jack van Dorp, breeding manager for the red beets. So for the team that works on the red beet breeding. And well, I like to show you the breeding goals we have as a team. First of all, I like to mention the general quality aspects. Like we like to have a smooth skin, of course. Shape is important in general, a round shape, but of course we also work on the elongated ones, and it's very important that we have a consistent shape. root, and by root I mean that we can see on the right side a very heavy red tail. Well, if we want a refined beet and the growing conditions are moderate, we like to have a beet with a nice refined root. But if you have more heavy circumstances, then we need, of course, a bit stronger root. And that is in combination with the tops, of course. Color is an important one, not just externally, but of course also internally, as you can see on the pictures below. So that's also where we do quite heavy selection on. If you go to the tops, beside the disease programs we have, we always like to look for an overall health. So not just focus on one disease and maybe give some, create some more susceptibility on another disease. We like to have an overall good health, good tops with a good surface for production. The attachment depends a little bit on the area where we grow the beet. If we have a moderate climate, we like to have a refined attachment of the tops, so the crown is small size. But if you have more heavy conditions, as you also can see here on this picture, you see more stronger tops. But then, of course, you can imagine the implant will be a bit more bigger. So that's all about balance for the area you are working for. And for the tops, we also focus on the color, because in short day length circumstances, more heavy weather circumstances, often the tops have the tendency to go more in the red direction. And that makes that the production capacity goes down. So we select for green tops because we like the material to produce. Another other breeding goals are earliness. So for the start of the season, if the production is a bit higher, it can help you in opening the market. But it can also help in the end of the season, maybe for a second crop, so that you still have production enough to have a mature crop. Another one is a monogerm. Now, we all know that we can have several beets out of what we call one seed, but in fact it is, we can see it a little bit, we see the two branches of the flowers, and the bottom one, we have more flowers close together, and during the development, they will cluster together, and then we think it's one seed, but it's more composition of several seeds that gives the multi-germity. And monogermity can of course give you a better control over the distribution of your seeds over the field, but what is important for the breeding is that we also combine it with a good seed production, because the more extreme monogerm genetics have just a very limited amount of seeds on a flowering branch. So of course it's good that we also can produce our varieties. Content matter, and then we talk about Brix and betanin, is also of interest, of course. We besides measuring several trials to have an idea how it works, what's going on, we also have programs running to raise the Brix and the betanin in our material. And then I mentioned the most important diseases we work on. So beet necrotic yellow vine virus, the rhizomania. That's one of the most important we can see over here. The resistance we have built in some of our varieties at the moment is the more common resistance. But we also started up with adding another gene, which will give complete resistance to the areas where we have problems with resistant breaking strains. So that's something we focus on. For the rest, Cercospora is a really important one for the tops, of course. For nematodes, we focus on the bee chyst nematode for Western Europe, but also root knot for the more the Mid Americas and also the South Americas, where it is mainly the problem at the moment. And the last one I mentioned is Rhizoctonia. It's a difficult one. It's not black and white. It's not like you have very good sources, but we see that with selection, we can raise the level. So yeah, I think that is in a short way, the most important breeding goals we work on.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, Jack and Robert, for your presentation. I see one question. I think it's a good question for Robert. How many large areas of yellow and white beets are there in Western Europe?
If you talk about the area, yeah, it's in all the countries there are some areas of some hectares of yellow and white beets, but it's not a large one. It's still a small crop. It's a very healthy crop for the it's attractive for children. The taste is very good, but it's not, yeah, it's still a niche market. So I don't know how big the area is in total, but if you talk about a couple of hundred hectares, it will be, yeah, absolutely more or less like that.
Thank you. And another question, I think for Jack. Can you tell something about the spreading of rhizomania?
Yeah, there we are. It's also for me difficult to say where we exactly are, but we hear more and more problems with it. Mainly in areas where in the past, or maybe not, well, close past, have been sugar beet productions. But sometimes it can also be in areas where never have been a sugar beet, and all of a sudden we have some samples sent into pathology, and then it turns out to be rhizomania. Especially areas where we have, like in Holland, where we have all the ditches and the surface water and we can have good irrigation. It seems that the spreading over there is more quickly than areas where people use source water for irrigation, for example. I think that is what I can tell about it at the moment.
Okay, thank you, Jack. And I think what the leaf tops.
Yeah, what was the question?
Okay, sorry, there was a problem with my microphone. One more question about the leaf tops. Can you explain a little bit more about the connection between the color of the tops and the circumstances of the cultivations?
Now, what we see in general is that when, especially when the material, when your beet field becomes a bit mature, and it depends a bit which area. For example, in Holland, when you go to the end of the season, days are shortening, and in general, then you see that the tops become more and more red. But it can also be influenced by bad weather when you have an well, kind of ugly. Second part of the summer, also this problem you will face, and then with selection for more greener tops, they keep producing better. Also in short day length, we see that the greener tops are more stable in production, and it also helps. We see that more and more people are using top lifters, but if you have a healthy top on it, of course, you are in a better position with your top lifter than when they become really purple and have difficulties to keep growing very well.
Okay,
I hope that is the answer to the question. But
okay. And I think one more question about resistances for Lusitania. In sugar beets, they talk about resistances. Is that also possible for red beet, you think?
Yeah. Yeah, we also check that. And the thing is, because some resistances are claimed in the sugar beets, and then when we check the material and then try it under our circumstances and the way we think resistance should work, then it turns out that maybe they are slightly better, but we are far from what we like to call resistant. So we checked it because we hope that maybe it could also help us in, of course, in the way how to tackle this problem. But in general, it's the resistance is not that high in sugar beet.
Thank you for your answers. Robert and Jörg, thank you for your presentations. I want to invite Lisbeth for her presentations about the seed coatings.
Well, good morning. Thank you for attending this presentation. And I was asked to provide a short update of the research of Bayo concerning seed quality control, and more specifically for the control of seed transmitted diseases and seedling diseases. First, let me explain what the type of pathogens of our concern are. And of course, plant pathogens can consist of bacteria, fungi, viruses, but also pests like nematodes. When the location or the origin of the disease is in soil or in an environment in general, we consider those diseases soil or field-borne. When the pathogen is detected in the seed batch or even on or in the seeds, we consider them seed-borne. Luckily, not all seed-borne inoculum will transmit towards the established seedling. So it is only a very small proportion of the diseases that can be detected in seeds and also have the possibility to transmit in the seedling. A known seed-transmitted disease is Foma beta. Foma beta is a fungus that causes black legs at the bottom of the young seedlings. However, I do have to say that when you have a problem like this, it's not necessarily related to a seed infection. It could also be a soil infection. But having said this, of course, all the seeds that we produce worldwide are inspected for the presence of Foma beta. We can do that using molecular techniques, but a very robust and reliable method still is to put the seeds on agar, incubate them under near ultraviolet light, and then inspect the colonies for typical mycelial growth of Foma. And in this way, we can easily calculate the percentage of seeds in a seed batch that carry inoculum with Foma beta. Well, if these types of batches do occur, we have our measures to take control, one of them being seed coating. And of course, seed coating is a multipurpose treatment, so it helps the visibility of the seed in the soil. It reduces the dust from a seed batch, and it also provides a better flowability of the seeds in machines. But seed coatings are also potential carriers of additives on seeds. Well, the most traditional additive in a seed coating is, of course, the use of fungicides. However, I don't think I tell you anything new that the regulated fungicides for beetroot seeds have changed drastically over the past 20 years. And in fact, the broad spectrum fungicides that we used to carry on our seeds for a very long time have all been banned. So carbendazim, Tyrum, Iprodium, and more recently also Metalaxyl have been banned for treatment in the Netherlands and to be sold in the EU. To give an overview of the effects that we used to have by these broad spectrum fungicides, it completely covered all the seed-borne and seedling damping off diseases, and not only for beetroot, but in fact for all of our crop that we could provide to our customers worldwide. We have lost all of these products by now, and to show it in a table, what the consequences are for our main crops in the EU, and I included some other crops to show you that it is not only a problem for red beet. All the crops that we carry have changes in the regulated fungicides for seeds. However, when you look at red beet, it is very clear that ever since this year, we have lost all the registrations of fungicides for seeds. When I show the comparison of the other areas in the world, there is a change. Of course, they also have changed over time, but we are still allowed to treat red beet for the USA in the Netherlands with the number of fungicides. And we're also still allowed to treat red beet for exports to the rest of the world using fungicides. However, for the EU, we are no longer allowed to put fungicides on the seeds and plant them. This, of course, has a consequence for our way to control seed transmitted diseases using fungicides. But do not forget that it also has a large consequence for the control for seedling damping off. And this is an example of Rhizoctonia, but the same applies, in fact, for Fusarium or Pythium. At a very young stage, so this graph shows that in the first 4 weeks, the vulnerability of beetroot seedlings is very high for Rhizoctonia, whereas if there is any tolerance against Rhizoctonia, it does kick in at the fifth week stage. So the early establishment of the seeds are very vulnerable when there is no good control or good buffering capacity in the soil for Rhizoctonia. Of course, we have been testing all kinds of combinations on seed treatments to see how we can replace the traditional fungicides. This is just one example of a lot of seed treatments that we have been trying to investigate for its protective measures against, in this case, FOMA-infested soil. It's probably better explained when I explain it in a left and a right half. So on the left side, you see five variations of fungicides. And the fifth bar shows the treatment with Metalaxyl, Tyrem, and Iprodium, so the seed treatment that we carried until 2018. It shows a high number of seedlings established, and it also shows, when looking at the black at the bottom, that there is no diseased seedlings. We have been comparing mainly against Sedaxan and Fludioxanil, the first two bars in this graph, because we were hopeful that these fungicides could have a registration for beetroot seeds. And to be honest, unfortunately, they're still not registered for seed treatment. We are hopeful that Fludioxanil at one time may come through, but at this stage, we have to conclude that no synthetic fungicides are available for beetroot. When you look at the right side, you see the outermost rightest bar shows the naked seeds. The bar next to it shows the seed coding by itself without any additives, and that shows that seeds without any protection are very vulnerable for seed-borne inoculum. So there's a lower amount of seedlings established, and also a relatively high proportion of the seeds show symptoms. We tested randomly from the biostimulants that are in the market currently whether they could improve tolerances to soil-borne diseases. But in this case, it's very clear that there's also no claim from biostimulants, but it is also indeed not found. So there's the same problem, a lower number of seedlings established and a relatively high proportion of the seedlings showing the symptoms. It doesn't mean that biostimulants couldn't be helpful in helping with the overall disease protection, but when planting seeds treated with the biostimulant on diseased soil, there is no protection to be expected. We also tested two biofungicides, and of course there's many biofungicides in the market nowadays. However, none of them have been registered for seed treatment. And these two are from companies that are interested in getting these products registered for seed treatment. So that is very hopeful, especially when we look at the results. So they have a very good establishment of seedments. However, one of the two also still shows a relatively high vulnerability to disease symptoms. Biofungicide 1 compares very well to the fungicide treatment with Metalaxa and Tyrem. So there's a good establishment of the seedlings. And yes, there still is a minor proportion of the seedlings affected, but that of course is when being exposed to quite a high load in the soil inoculum. Well, to secure the delivery of healthy seeds to our customer, we have invested in the development of hot water treatment protocols and steam vacuum treatment protocols. It is not just one treatment treats all, but we have developed protocols that are suitable for the crop and pathogen in place, resulting in the highest efficacy and while maintaining the best seed quality. And of course, the details of these treatments are proprietary, but we strive for the best results. And of course, we confirm that efficacy both in lab test and in greenhouse test, but we also do so in field trials. This table shows an overview of a large number of seeds that were treated, where the untreated versus treated have been investigated, indicating that the efficacy against the FOMA beta seed inoculum is very high and that a good seed quality is maintained. Here I come to my last slide with some take-home messages. And that is that unfortunately in the EU, no seed treatments, no fungicide seed treatments are available. And to be honest, we fear that they are not likely to return. We are hopeful, but we fear that they are not likely to return. Of course, the search for alternative seed treatments is ongoing, and we support the registrations with research that is required for such registrations. The delivery of healthy beetroot seeds is secured by using in-house developed treatment protocols and adequate testings. But please be aware that the buffering capacity or the improvement of the buffering capacity of soil is extremely important in these days. I thank you for your attention.
I think not, so
okay.
Go on with Marcel about Eastern Europe.
Yes, hello everyone.
Good day everyone. Thank you for participating in this RedBeet virtual event. I will tell you something about the region I'm working with in Eastern Europe. The content will be some about acreages, some cultivation and market developments, and the possibilities of red beet. And later on, we can have some questions by the chat. Talk about our region. You see the purple color. It's a very large region in the world. But I also have to tell you that the northern part in Russia, there is no any vegetables and also no red beet possible. But it is a very large area in the world, and a big part is also red beet. If you look here, I divide it, let's say, in four parts because it's enormous. So if we speak about the Baltics, Belarus and Ukraine, I see it as one part with about 13,000 hectares. Russia is our main country where red beets are grown, almost close to 18,000. And if we go more to the south, then we have various countries like the Caucasus and Central Asia, for example, like Georgia or like Uzbekistan, Kazakhstan, that counts about 8,000 hectares. Then we have also in the southeast of Europe, with countries like Hungary, Romania, Croatia, and also Greece, where they're about 4,000 hectares. What about the growing season 2021? The weather influenced a lot. There were some in springtime also rainfall, therefore was later sowing. And after that, some heavy rain again, and a lot of, let's say, sunshine and temperature. If you look at the dark red color in how in Europe it is, then you can imagine that it will not favor our production this year. So the production has been not really increased, maybe stable or decreased. But in any case, that has also an influence on its price. If we mention here the Baltics and the Belarus about how fields look like, of course, there are smaller growers, there are larger growers, and also there are various type of soils. Like, for example, in the right bottom, you can find also peat soil, which you can find in the north of these countries. Next to it, they grow it in ways like on a full field with 35 centimeters between each row, but also on ridges and, of course, on beds. That's always possible. Let's say at the end of April, that is the sowing time. And till the first harvest will be in July. And finally, all the harvest will continue until October, because after that, it will go into the storage. Ukraine, of course, also a large country. The north region is similar, let's say, to the Baltic Belarus. The south region, they can have earlier sowing in the end of March already. And again, also in July, sowing for the long storage. But in Ukraine, they also have, because of the climate, they use also the drip irrigation, which you can see on the right picture. And with the drip irrigation, they can give also extra fertilization. If we talk about these three countries and we talk about market developments, at the moment, the prices for red beets are rather high. They are between, let's say, 20, 25 cents, which is a very good price. In Lithuania, we have some big companies, cooperatives, but they make contracts, so we don't know what's their price. In any case, the price in Lithuania for, professional growers, it can raise up till 25 cents, 30 cents, because of, depends on how it is washed, packed, etc. But in this market, it's mainly the round beet which is dominating. The colored beet are in an experimental stage, and in the market you find as well fresh marked and processed beets. And then you must talk about that it is steamed, it's peeled, vacuum, and then boiled, and also present in soup products. The number of hybrids, especially in Belarus, Ukraine, is about 70%. In the Baltics, it's some higher, which are used. If we talk about the production, then in Ukraine is slightly decreasing, but that has also to do with that they have more the local demand for domestic use. But like the Belarus and, let's say, like Lithuania and Baltics, they have a little increase, because they have a little export possible. For example, from the Belarus, it goes, for example, for a little export to Russia. If you go to Russia, then their developments are that in the central part, Ural, they can sow it in May and half of September. But in the south region, which is, of course, a big distance from the central part, they can have the two crops. That can be also as a second crop. But of course, they can also have it for later for some storage or later harvest. But because of this climate, they also use in irrigation also this pivot irrigation, which you can see on the right picture for big, large surfaces. The market developments also in Russia, the price at the moment is about 22 euro cents, and that is twice higher compared to last season, last year. So it means, the people who has the product, they make good prices, but that is because of lower production this year. Also in Russia, it's mainly the round beet, and as well fresh mark processing are also present. But in the processing, we think about cooked salads, some soups, and also some other things as well. For professional growers, the production is rather stable. But what we notice is that due to the COVID, there is less vegetable consumption in the country. So the consumers are returned back more to the basic vegetables. So the more luxury vegetables, maybe they are, not chosen anymore. So that's maybe for our some varieties from us, from some crops for us, and especially red beet, it's also good. Russia produces also enough quantity for its own market. There's a kind of small import, about 10,000 tons. But yeah, the country is so big, so that is it's nice. Southeast Europe. So what I mentioned with the, let's say, the Hungary and Croatia and till Greece, we have two areas, the continental area and also the Mediterranean areas. On the fields, you can also see, let's say, on the right top, also pivot by Serbia. And in the right bottom, it's the Mediterranean area, and that is in Greece. And they use also sprinkling irrigation. Greece has a full year-round cultivation. And also you can see it in the coastal line of some Croatia, which can also have a long harvesting period and also start early. About market developments, in prices, it's also about 20-25 cents. But there's also a difference when you are in Hungary, for example, they have a lot of industry, and then the prices are around 10 cents. So that is much lower than the fresh market prices. Even it's possible, what I heard about in Croatia, that there are people, they can make 40 cents of beets, but probably that is fully washed, packed, etc. In any case, these are the prices. If we talk about round shape, long shape, then it's dividing 90%, 10% for, let's say, some countries. But for Hungary, it's about 60-40. So 60% round beets, 40% long beets. The real fresh markets are in the south, like Greece, Cyprus, and Albania. So that dominates over there. And in Greece, they have as well some short tops with bunching with short tops. The other countries, there is the industry very important for the canning, for acidity and pasteurized, and it's a rather stable market. The juice industry in Hungary, that is increasing at the moment. And now, in the previous presentations, we heard already something about betanine, Brix, but also dry matter. These are content things which are very important for this kind of industries. So the production in this region in totally is stable and a little increase, but that really depends on the industry, how their demand is. That brings us to the last part of countries. This is the Caucasian countries and Central Asia. Here we find really also small growers, small plots, which you can see on the left, mini tunnels where they grow red beets for very early cultivation, because they could start in February already, and it starts and that continues till the last harvest in December. So they are fields, also big fields, but mainly these are smaller growers. In this country, also the price about 18-20 cents for red beets, but that is mainly round beet. It is for fresh market, and stable production, and mainly for domestic use. There is some export to Russia when Russia is demanding. On the right, you see a picture how by hand harvested the red beet is done. Then I also, in other countries, you see much more involvement of machinery with belt harvesters, but also with, let's say, potato harvesters. And on the right bottom, you find also a new yellow harvester, and that's made in Lithuania. And over there is a cooperative which has more than, let's say, 300 hectares of red beets, and that is increasing. And also they have their market demand, let's say, from Italy and France. If we talk about storage, storage can be done in a short way and a long way. Of course, beets are also put there near straw bales. And next to it, you also can find it inside in big storage rooms and also with some ventilation channels. Then about the possibilities for red beet and especially market sales in a lot of countries. Still, there are street markets where a lot of vegetables are sold. That is still very common in these countries. So also you can find their red beets with foliage in per piece in plastic sealed. But also supermarkets are appearing and also are getting more and more influence and also more and more market share. So finally, the supermarkets will be getting bigger and bigger with different products packed, sorted out, washed, etc. Now, that brings me to my last slide about the possibilities for red meat, especially in northern countries and also in Russia, Ukraine. They like very much this peeled, steamed, peeled and boiled vacuum pack. But also next to it, we have soup products. There is cooked salads. There are herring salads. A lot of things are possible with red meat. Red meat is also very healthy. It's full of iron. And that's the reason why you see in the middle is white white bottles. This is for medical use. When you drink red meat juice, it will take more oxygen. So for sports people or for medical use, it can be very favorable. And that's a very nice product, yeah, which can maybe have new possibilities for the near future. In any case, in Eastern Europe, also the content matters, the Brix level, the flavor, the taste, also what was mentioned by Robert Schilder, is also very important in our region. Thank you for your attention. And when there are questions, please ask them through the chat. Thank you.
Okay, Marcel, many thanks. I see one question.
Okay.
More for the south of Europe. So I think we can, after the film, the Arctic can
okay, that's good.
Answer that question. And maybe when there are more questions, we can do that after the film.
Very welcome.
Okay. I will start the film. We make this film during the variety days this year. It's about our assortment with varieties. So let's have a look.
Welcome to our demo field for the red beets, and here we show all our varieties, and we like to focus a bit more on the latest introductions we have in the red beet. Bazoo is a variety we should place in between Pablo and Boro, and then more in the direction of Boro. Yeah, it's a very nice smooth beet with good tops. About the tops, we selected for quite some years on green healthy tops. Because in autumn we see that sometimes tops, when the days are shortening, become a bit more red. And for this one we selected on really green tops. So also in the end of the season it still keeps producing. Very consistent in shape, nice round shape, very very smooth beet, good root attachment, so that it is comparable with Boro. And I think the big advantage is that it is also Rhizomania resistant variety. Looking at our varieties, Bresco is a variety we should place between Pablo and Boro, and then closer to Boro. Bresco is a very smooth beet, nice root attachment, comparable in the direction of Boro. The attachment of the tops is also quite fine. The variety was selected on green tops, so in autumn time when days shortening, tops stay green and it keeps producing. In general, it's quite a productive variety. Bresco has no additional resistances. Manolo is a variety we should compare with Pablo. We call it Pablo with better continental qualities. If you look at the beet, it is just the root attachment is a bit more heavy compared to Pablo. Also the leaf and plant a little bit, but not too much. It's not as heavy, for example, as we can have with the Boro. So therefore it is just a bit stronger than Pablo. As you can see, it's a very nice, very smooth beet. So yeah, we can use it in the markets where we sometimes think maybe Pablo is a little bit too weak and this one is a bit stronger. Below is a variety with Reishamania resistance. Our first introduction in Reishamania resistance was Manzhou, but Manzhou sometimes is a little bit conical. The root attachments can be quite heavy, so that was the reason to come with Palau. Palau is more round, and also the root is a little bit more refined. And we use those varieties in the areas, of course, where the Reishamania pressure can be present, which is mainly in Western Europe.
Thank you. That was the last point in our webinar. I see one question. I think Jack can maybe answer it. It's about an alternative for red cloud in a hot climate like Cyprus.
Yeah, well, I think... Of course, I'm not really sure how extreme we could call the climate, but the first variety I'm thinking of could be Bowan, as it is rather strong under the more heavy climate conditions. And maybe also Bresco would be strong enough, but that's something, maybe to test.
Thank you, Jörg. There is... Other question, I think, for Robert about the vacuum. How long it can last in a vacuum pack for the red beet?
Yeah, that's of course depending on the quality which is going in, but normally you can store it after cooking and vacuum packing for more or less a year or even longer. But the expiry date will be more or less a year.
Thank you, Robert. I have a look or more questions. One more question about the varieties. I think for Jack, what kind of varieties are most suitable for growing on sandy soils?
Yeah, I think you cannot give a single answer to that. It also depends a lot about the availability of water. Is it real sandy soil and is there really a lack of water? Then you want your most strongest beet with the most heavy roots, so at least it can reach some water. And then is the first one I think of is Bowan. But it can also be that if you are really in control over your water level, maybe you can even raise the soil water level, for example, then it can almost be every variety. But if it's really more dry, Bowan is the strongest, but also a variety like Boro or Bresco are a bit stronger for that. So they have a little bit more root and that can help.
Thank you. Thank you to all the speakers. I want to close with a short summary, and you also see in the screen a short survey about the quality of the webinar. We will ask you to fill this in to see how we do it in a good way. Small summary, we see the Reishamania as a growing problem in different countries. And yeah, we make the resistance varieties, but also the good quality, which you expect from the BGO varieties. We work together with processors, growers, and other knowledge parties in the chain to make the best product. We see a growing market in Eastern Europe and also a growing processing market. We see that the seed treatment is changed from chemicals to more other new treatments like biologicals to make a good start in the field. And when there are more questions, please ask your local sales representative. And I want to thank you. Okay.
Wat is het? Dan had ik.